It says, do you not know your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you're not your own? You don't even belong to yourself. I don't. That's good, because I couldn't afford to pay the bill, could I? He paid it. God intends for your body to perform three essential functions. One, your body identifies you as a unique person. When I see different ones of you, I know who you are. I know who you are, and I've met you, talked together, or broke bread together, or done stuff together, and I know who you are. When I see you, I know you're a unique person. I know who you are. Helps me recognize. The second thing, it allows you to participate. When Jesus was in heaven, and he needed to come to earth, and he had fulfilled his purpose to come to earth and to be incarnated, born in the flesh, into a body like ours, he came to be born because he couldn't accomplish what he needed to do for God without a body. He had to have a body in order to do what he did, which is to eventually not only teach and preach, which he did, and travel, which he did, but he also was visible to people, and he wouldn't have been visible if he remained in the Spirit. So he had to take upon himself a body that was identifiable. And he could walk, and he ate, and he got hungry, and he got tired, and he prayed in that body, and he healed, he was used, the Holy Spirit through him healed people, and fed people, and did things. So he participated in the world while not being of the world. He was in the world, but not of it. That's what he wants us to do. So your body helps you to communicate with other people. People can touch you, they hear you speak. You're able to do things and help other people. And your body allows you to influence this creation. You and I cannot influence the creation around us in the Spirit. We can do through prayer, but sometimes he wants us to put our feet into action. He wants us to put our hands on it, do something. So our body can move to place and fulfill the purpose of God. By the way, the very first humans, without any external negative influence, failed to do what God asked them to do. First two, all by themselves. No TV. No video games. No deacons' kids. Nothing. It's like it was just them. And so they failed to obey. Instead of partnering with God in this world, which was God's original plan, they selfishly decided to do their own thing, their own way. And the result was when they sinned, their good bodies were invaded by a sinful nature. And that's why today we still hurt when we move, get hungry, have pain, and so forth, sickness. But your body can still be used to do good. And I'm not just going to talk about physical body tonight, but you got to start there because that's who we're born in. We're a soul living in a physical body in my life. Paul wrote about it. Read Romans chapter 7. I do what I don't want to do, and I don't do what I want to do. And I think of all the people that I've ever read about, Paul was probably one of the most zealous people and willing to sacrifice and to suffer for Christ of anybody. And he struggled. I had one guy tell me, he said, "That can't be Paul who wrote that, because he wouldn't, he's a godly man. He wouldn't have had that struggle." I said, "Get real." He struggled. He had a thorn in his flesh, it says. Didn't define it, but I have to say, we all have a thorn in the flesh. So how do you do it? Okay. See, this closet has lots of stuff in it. It does. It's got sin in there. You can't see it because it's just thoughts. Or private things. Nobody here sees it or hears it. So to you, it doesn't exist. It looks like there's nothing in my closet, but there's something in there. How do you clean out the stuff that should be in our life? Give me an idea. Pardon? Prayer. I just happen to have a container. It's full of living water. Holy Spirit water. Okay. Prayer. Now, if I were to try to get the air out of here like a vacuum pump, what would happen before I perfectly got every molecule of air out of there is this glass would shatter. That would be like trying to do it by myself. So we're going to try what Carol said. We're going to pray. We're going to pray. All right? I got part of it out there. What else can I do? Oh, the Bible. I can put the Bible into my life. Put some Bible in there. Read the Bible. Memorize some. Okay, it's still not there though. What else do I need to do? Fasting. I could fast. You've gone to meddling. Meddling. I just put a little bit of that one in there. Fasting. What else could I do? Obey. Put a bunch of that in there. God likes that one. I'm still not completely out, though. What else can I do? I could rebuke the devil. I need to realize who is my tempter ultimately? The accuser, the liar, Satan. It's not any of you. Satan. All of the Bible. So if you say, "I don't know what to do in this situation," love God. But I don't know how to treat this other guy. I don't understand why they want to do it to love them. Did he say I have to agree with everything? No. But how am I going to be disagreeable? I guess. In a loving manner. So I just love people. So here's my question. We've got 4 minutes or 3 minutes. Are you a worldly Christian who has allowed Christ to enter your life, but you struggle with the desires of the flesh? Don't answer here. Some people struggle with this. And if you do, he's available to help. 2, are you a spiritual Christian who has been crucified with Christ and you're being controlled by the Holy Spirit? The more you surrender, the more you know this is a daily, ongoing part of life, just like heartbeats. God can't beat your heart once. You got to keep circulating the life of Christ. Spiritual Christians are not perfect. I had somebody trying to justify what they were doing because of what somebody else did. And I went, that doesn't work. I can't say because somebody else did something that I don't approve of. That means I can do whatever I want. Because the standard is not you, and the standard is not me. The standard is Jesus Christ. He's the gold standard, if you want to say that. He's the perfect one, perfect standard. When you're tempted, you and I need to learn to let Jesus Christ answer the door. Temptation comes knocking, you need to back to Jesus. Could you get that door? Jesus, would you answer that for me? Jesus, answer the door. I don't want to answer the door. Temptation. Let him do it. And daily, seek to stop living for your own pleasure. I was talking to a man about young people in the this young generation, they demand they have immediate gratification. They want a house. They want everything in it that's equal or better than their parents and grandparents ever had. They want it now, and they want it either by gifts or by credit or by something. They want everything, and they want it now. And immediate gratification gets you into trouble, not just credit, but with moral decisions, everything. You got to have your, I've always said that you got to make your mind up about temptation before you're tempted, because when you're tempted, it's too late.